Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Erich Joachimsthaler here. Erich is the founder and CEO of Vivaldi, and he's got a new book, The Interaction Field. And Erich has lectured or held faculty positions at Harvard, Yale, Columbia, Dartmouth, Duke, you name it. He's worked there, and he is so interesting. So I hope you stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Erich Joachimsthaler, who is the founder and CEO of Vivaldi, one of the largest independent global strategy and business transformation firms with offices in the US, Europe, Latin America, and Asia. He's lectured and held faculty positions at many of the world's leading business schools, including Harvard Business School, Yale, Columbia, Dartmouth. I mean, the list goes on and on. You have amazing background. And I want to say that you've written two award-winning books, and you have your most recent book, I'm really excited to talk to you about, is The Interaction Field. So welcome, Erich.
Yes. Welcome. Thank you so much, Diane. It's great to be here.
Well, I am really looking forward to this. As you know, I've taught several courses, and some of the courses I deal with a lot of the stuff you have spoken and written about, particularly interested in a lot of the branding stuff that you focus on. But before we get into your book and everything, that's quite a background you have. How did you reach this level of success? Can you give us the backstory?
I'm glad you stopped the list of where I was employed because it suggests that I'm a kind of guy who can't hold down a job.
Well, they're all good jobs, though.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I went through a journey. I arrived in this country years ago, and I was fascinated by a few things. And one of the things early on I was fascinated by is that in those days, the biggest value a company had was the physical assets. Think of GE, they have power plants, they have factories. And when you measure the value of the firm, then you found that the biggest value was what accountants could count, these numbers. And very little was this intangible thing, the brand, let's say, and intellectual capital and things like that. And now that's move this forward to today, Diane. And today you have just the opposite happening. You have the biggest value that companies have, you name them, any companies you name today, is the intangible. It's the brand, it's the reputation, it's the trust, it's this sometimes networks like the 100 million prime time customers of Amazon and things like that. And much less it is the physical assets. And so I went early on into this idea that brand is one way to capture that intangible value. That's where my world comes from a consumer and marketing perspective. And from then I evolved over the years. Now I am onto this new book, and I had to put it down because otherwise my mind would have been restless.
I hear you on that one. And I was looking at some of the people who've reviewed your book. I've met Rita McGrath, and she's part of the Thinkers 50 group that I was with in London recently. And you have such an amazing, all the people who have written wonderful things about this book. So I looked at a lot of what you're talking about, and it would have really helped me to have your work when I was writing a brand publishing course. When I left Forbes School of Business, one of the last things I did was write a brand publishing course based on the work that they had done looking at just how complicated it is for companies to deal with all the services and products and everything, and to reach the consumer with like a personal message at scale and all the, it's tough. I mean, I went to the Forbes CMO Summit and everybody was like, this is really, you know, we're trying to do all these things at scale and it's challenging. So you talked a lot about the eras of what we've gone through with branding. And I found your era discussion fascinating, and it led to your discussion about what company has been the biggest one. Can you go into that? I love that discussion.
You know, it dawned on me as I sort of reflected about what really happened. In 95, there was, of course, Jeff Bezos. And he basically created a technology called e-commerce. And that became Amazon. And and that was the first time where things on the internet connected. And there were then there were these two guys from Stanford, Larry Page and Sergio Brin. Of course, two guys that these labored around in their PhD program and coming up with a better way of finding stuff on the internet, all this. And look at them, if you will, what they did is they said, look, how are the information connecting? And we call this the page rank. And that way is the more a website or information connects to other information on the internet, so this network of information, the more valuable a page is or a website is, and the more we put that website on the top in search, because that's what people are looking for. And so that became the algorithm of and then they found advertising to way to monetize it, and the rest is history. And that was sort of the first time when Amazon just did the same thing. They just said, at the other end is not information, at the other end is a book, and I can sell the book. And anything else.
And everything else,
And that evolved really rapidly to 2000. And in 2000, around the later 2000s, then 2009, 2010, and 2007, what emerged is that you can't just connect information, you connect people. And the technology obviously became social networks or social media. And everything changed when Apple came up with a smartphone, because as you know, we are 85% of Americans wake up in the morning, first thing they do is look at the iPhone or whatever, the mobile phone, smartphone. And that connectivity was sort of the second wave, Diane, where I said, like, holy smoke, well, my company and I, we created something called social currency. You know, we were perplexed, why would people share things around brand? We call it a brand can have social currency, that people say, hey, I love Nike, you know, I celebrate Michael Jordan and things. That was 2009, but when the smartphone came together, that technology together with the social media, things took off in a massive way. And today, 2020, I look at it as another wave. And the wave is now that you can't just connect people and information and books and buy also commerce. The new technologies are machine learning, AI, the cloud computing has become big. Everyone, Amazon has one version, the AWS, and every major company, Microsoft has Azure. And what that does is now everything connects, and there's this exponential connectivity of companies, of people globally, anywhere, 24/7. We all live in some form of an interaction field where we are literally 24/7 on. We are not going to go off anymore. We are always on, and that changes the way you connect with companies 24/7. Companies connect with themselves in a real-time basis. And that, to me, is the biggest tech. You can look at individual technology, AI, and you can talk ad nauseum. But what never happened in the history of the world is that all of these technologies, machine learning, quantum computing, edge computing, cloud computing, all of these things have conspired now that we are connected. And what that has done, Diane, is that The way companies create value has changed. They don't create value anymore in the factory because they are better at producing something, better designing something, better marketing in their own four walls. What now happens is companies create values in the network. Call it platforms, call it digital ecosystems, call it interaction fields, I call it a business platform, call it e-commerce. All of it doesn't matter how you call it, but the value has value creation has shifted now, and that's what are those three eras, and we are now all of this exponentially happens, and it changes how you do branding, it's changing how you innovate, it's changing how you scale a business, how you connect with consumers, the whole nine yards, how you work actually from home, you know, with Zoom technologies.
I love that. And I was watching one of your talks you gave, you talked about what, if you'd asked people 10 years ago, what would be the top company, what people would say. Mm-hmm. And I even was interested in just, you know, I hadn't considered that it wouldn't be Apple or Amazon or Netflix. Can you share that? Because I love when you get into the machine learning aspect of getting the 60 points part. I'd like to go all the way through that because I think this is a really important thing that I'd like to share with not only my audience, but my students. I think this is a great story.
Yeah, but absolutely. The nobody would have expected who is on the top today. In the same way, and you know, and the value they create. Think of Apple. Mm-hmm. In 2 years. So 2 years ago, August, about 1 month ago or two, August 2018, mm-hmm. Apple was the first company to become a $1 trillion value company.
Wow!
And guess what? In 2 years, they have doubled it. They are now the only company that's a $2 trillion company. Look at Amazon today. Amazon is not only one of the richest companies in the world. It made also Jeff Bezos the richest man in the world.
Right.
And if you look at August, just a few months ago, August during the last few months is actually on one day. This one man, Jeff Bezos, who is a shareholder, one of the major shareholders of Amazon, that Jeff Bezos in one day earned $13.5 billion.
Wow.
So the numbers are astronomical. These companies, they call them sometimes FANGAs, Facebook, Apple, Netflix, Google, Apple. They call them, sometimes they add an M to it because Microsoft is also up in that league now. They have pioneered a new way of creating value, and that's the secret sauce of their success model. Other companies have now of the top 12 largest companies in the world, they all have been trying to duplicate or at least to mimic some of that success with different levels of success. Of the 13 IPOs that are just coming out today, it is Palantir and Asana. Of the 13 that are coming out in the IPO window now, 8 of them are all building this business on this new wave that I was just talking about earlier. And the game has changed, and companies are, what I said in my book is I'm going to describe some of the companies, real companies, like with assets, like a John Deere, let's say, or a metal company, a metal distributor, let's say, called Kleckner. And I describe what these companies must do to become successful in this new world. Tesla, I describe, and so forth.
Well, I think those are all really great to look at. And as you're bringing up the IPOs, mm-hmm. I have daughters who work in Silicon, one in Silicon Valley, one in Southern California.
You're lucky.
You're lucky. Visit
you don't
great
have
places.
To pay for them anymore.
That's
they
right.
pay for you.
They feel, that's right. You can you say that one more time just in case they're listening. But they, you know, I know that they work for, you know, one works for a startup, and I know a lot of the startups in these areas, they all want to be unicorns, right? And
yes.
they all want to be the next, you mentioned Amazon, Netflix,
yes.
Facebook, all those things. But yes. I, you know what I found fascinating was your discussion about the one stock that's the more valuable than any other stock from 10 years ago wasn't Netflix or Amazon or Facebook. You said it was Domino's Pizza.
Yes.
Now, that to me is something I don't think a lot of people would have realized. And what I loved was your discussion about how they got to that level.
Yes.
Can you go into that a little bit?
Yes. See, there is always this belief that that only technology companies can do that.
Mm-hmm.
And because it's easier, and Salesforce is a B2B example, Apple is a good example, and maybe Amazon that have done this, and they start almost technology first. But what I found very interesting is with Domino's, that Domino's actually was able to do the same thing. And this is not a surprise. If you look, for example, at their Chicago headquarters, half of the 800 people in headquarters, half of them are technology people and digital people and that. So they have built an organization around.
Which is really interesting, because you're thinking they're pizza makers or pizza testers or whatever, but
that's
they're tech
right.
people, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But you will find on my blogs and in my speeches this description of how they went through several eras. You know, they started, when I came to America at least, I played hide and seek with a pizza delivery person in an international student dormitory, because we knew that if we hide enough from the delivery person, in 30 minutes past, we get the pizza for free.
There
Remember?
Uh-huh.
That's how it started.
Right.
30 minutes or it's free.
Uh-huh.
And in the dormitory, we had plenty of rooms and floors where we could hide. And we says, we are not there. You can't find us. And we didn't exploit it too much, but
uh-huh.
once in a while, it was the fun part of it. Domino's Pizza went over this, but here's what happens is there's sort of a point where suddenly Domino's Pizza would deliver the pizza at the right place, but then at one point in time Domino's Pizza decided, and they had, of course, street locations, you know, usually in the main street where I was, where all the students congregate at the hill or something like that, the corner, we call it, on the campus, where all the bars are, where the students go. There usually was a Domino's Pizza. So in that business, it was location was
right.
important, and the quality of the pizza and all these things.
Which they changed.
But at
right?
some point, yeah, that's right.
Uh-huh.
But now, you know, at one point in time, Domino's Pizza said, we are going to change this. The game is different.
Mm-hmm.
What if we take a mobile order and we take the data and the information about the person that orders? And what we will get really good at is having a first, they call it first data, a direct relationship with that consumer, to the point that we can predict when that consumer wants his next pizza, to the point where I have more and more over time can so totally figure out. Erich Joachimsthaler is a coach for his son in his soccer. On a Saturday, he's most likely found in on the soccer field with a soccer team of 11 or 12 boys.
Uh-huh.
And what we need to do is send a note to Eric's mobile phone, because he always has it in his hand.
Right.
and Eric all needs to, with his face recognition, all needs to say, needs to look at it and says pizza.
Mm-hmm.
And we deliver before the finish of the game for 12 boys and the coach pizza on the on the soccer field. So they figured out, they said, we surround a consumer, we understand them fully, and we make the most easy. So we apply technology, data, and analytics to establish an interaction field. You can find me on the Upper West Side where I live. You can find me Saturdays on a soccer field, and on and on and on. And by building this system, it wasn't anymore like the old days where they had to do advertising about 30 minutes or you get it for free, right, and all these promotions. They just figured out how to establish a relationship in the 150 different ways. I want the Domino's pizza. Erich is in the office. You know, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. He has a sort of a downer because it's sort of the middle of the day. Erich celebrates something. He pressed a button. The whole office gets pizza. And, you know, Erich is very worried about whether the pizza arrives in time. So I can actually see on my mobile phone when that my pizza goes into the oven, when Fred takes it out, when Dickie is actually delivering it, and I know when the person arrives at my kitchen. I don't have to get off the office and so forth. So seamless, and I don't have to pay for it. Actually, I pay for it, but I don't notice because it goes automatically.
Right.
But change. So what has happened? That Domino's Pizza has, in the classic marketing of develop a quality product, promoted and branded, called Domino's Pizza promotion, you know, 50, you know, pizza off if it's not delivered 30 minutes. They have changed that to we primarily connect directly with consumers, doesn't involve much advertising anymore. We surround the consumers, we track the consumers. Erich likes to be tracked, don't mind to be tracked, let's say. you know, there's nothing sensitive to what parts of towns I'm going to.
Uh-huh.
So they know that, look, uh-huh, location services. And through that data, analytics, and technology, they have at scale created a business model, which we call a platform business model, and an ecosystem or an interaction field, in order to drive that stock price where it is. And the company became hugely profitable, and with that also the stock price was actually bigger than any other company but Netflix.
You know, it's such an interesting story, and I know you also had added that they do they would let you use your iPhone to take pictures of any pizza that you eat to get points.
Yes.
For every time you eat pizza, so that they could give you, after 60 points, you'd get a free pizza. But that was such genius, because if you're looking at, even if it's not their pizza, you know how much they've consumed, and you reward them for that, right? And
yes.
So there's so much data out there that you said you don't worry about it, but do you worry that there's too much data that they could find you, that everybody's listening? You know, actually, when I listened to your talk, you said her name, Alexa, I won't say it because she turns on, and then you said pizza, and she started to order one for me when I was listening. But do you worry that...
I must say that I've been suspicious because my daughter bought a Amazon Alexa.
Uh-huh.
And it's kind of a nice experience because you can get upset with somebody without offending anybody in your family. You can say, Alexa, play Spotify. Alexa, stop it. So you can command, and nobody, and she will say, of course, sir, I will find it, you know.
It's not a problem for me, but some people have a problem with that, though. Do you have a problem with them knowing anything?
My daughter just told me, she says, like, it's kind of strange that in the living room we were talking about buying these yoga mats, and suddenly I get all these yoga mat ads.
Somebody's listening.
You know, when I'm online. So I don't like the idea that she listens to our conversations,
right,
and then deducts that you need a, that goes too far. But you know what? What I have found, Diane, is that the most incredible pizza, obviously delivery, I don't really care about that.
Yeah.
I'm a member of Nike Plus on the Nike Run Club for 20 years since it started, or 15 years. But what I have found is that in my research for the book is that there is health situations. There are like 18 million Americans are diagnosed with cancer. And believe it or not, several million of these people who are in treatment centers for their cancer conditions actually voluntarily provide the data, all kinds of health data about themselves, their physical fitness, and all the treatment data in about 1,500 hospitals, care centers, and what the doctor does and what the nurse does, and on a daily basis. And these data are aggregated by a company called Flatiron Health and makes this data available to all the competitors of drugs. You say like, I would be very sensitive about my health data. It affects my insurance. And by the way, look, I don't want to know everybody to know my records. May find an employment condition. I don't get life insurance anymore, and all these things. So it's a little bit private. But what happens is, and this is why this is so important in this day we live today. What happens is that by doing this, by sharing this data, what we have now, the research has now found that for some of the cancer diagnosis we have, in the old days we would just give them Avastin, which is a Pfizer drug or an alternative drug from Roche and other pharmaceutical companies, and we would put you on the therapy for 3 months. You know what happens? You vomit, you lose your hair, you get headaches, you lose everything, all sorts of, you lose weight and all sorts of things, and have a real bad condition. And they found now that through the data that in many conditions or some conditions, you don't actually need the drug. You actually can get away with a different kind of eating, a kind of diet that you would use, a different kind of a therapy that is much less invasive. And what it has done is that this whole system, this whole data has enabled, is now that the drug administration that approves drug has now said, well, based on these data, which is data from real patients, not laboratory experiments, real data, real world evidence, they call it. Based on that, we approve the drug for certain conditions much earlier than usually, which means that you really save lives. So the benefits that of sharing even the most precious personal data are so powerful in this hyper-connected world, this interaction field world, this today that you can solve real big problems like having a cancer diagnosis and surviving that over the 18 months that you have on the average of living.
Well, you know, it's fascinating. I worked for AstraZeneca 15 years in pharmaceuticals, and we had Novodex and cancer drugs and all those, you know, and I think of all the things that have changed since I haven't been with them in probably 20 years since I've worked there, but it's been a while. But I'm thinking of all the data, of all the, you know, I know I saw, you know, they're working with Bayer and all the different companies that are looking at COVID kind of solutions. Is this data going to make it so much easier to do it faster because of what we've learned, or have we not had enough experiences with this COVID yet to have that data that we need to solve this major problem?
What is happening is the evolution was first, the data was used in almost a self-serving way by companies like, let's say, Amazon. They say, I know exactly what Diana is buying. Uh-huh. And then next time you go on Amazon, then there will be an ad that says, other people like you also bought XYZ. Would you like to buy? Click, click, you're in a basket, and then you buy stuff Diane doesn't need, right?
Or something would retarget you.
That's right. Yeah, retargeting stuff. And that was sort of like almost self-serving. It's increasing the basket size for Amazon and so forth. And what has happened now is that in this new people have now said, look, this is not how things should be. We need to create, and that's why I call it in my book, shared value, not just my own value, or not just for customers, but for society at large, and sort of like talking about, not just talking about purpose, but actually delivering on a larger social purpose. And so now what has happened in the medical field, in the healthcare field, in automotive, in many other fields actually, that I studied, is that these data are now shared within participants in an ecosystem, like in the agricultural fields, a fertilizer company, the crop company, the agricultural university that research on productivity of the field, with all the farmers and all of these. And they all come together and says, we are not only solving for better productivity of the farm, or profitability of the farm, but we are a farmer, but we also serving for a larger question, namely healthy food for everyone. So, and in the healthcare field, as your example, and the pandemic situation, you know, think of the example right now. The biggest worry, at least I have, is that they are pushing the vaccine down an accelerated pace. And you don't ever know what you take when you take a vaccine. An accelerated pace also can have real problems, because right. you go through testing of animals and testing on mice and things like that. Mm-hmm. So what happens is now with this data, much more massive amounts of data. So we can say that, for example, a person over the age of 50 in California, living under sun in a sunny warmer temperature, has this kind of, with a weight conditions of that, has that kind of a reaction. And then another person that lives in New York City and the stresses of the New York police department that gives you tickets on the streets and whatever, subway and all the things, how New Yorkers are, it's a very different stress situation, and he reacts in that way. In the pandemic, these data become incredibly useful, because they are provided by human beings, and we can now discern sort of the side effects, not on a general basis. If you read the side effects, like of anything, like in general, you know, you may vomit, you may have headaches, you may lose your hair, you may lose your weight.
Oh, you will
your insomnia, whatever, you know, sexual drive disappears and all sorts of things. You go like, and I'm gonna go on that one, you know, and you of course think that you are not the one, but through this data that we have, that this enables through this hyperconnectivity, I think we can now apply treatments in the health situation we live right now, the pandemic, more specific and says for this condition. So it's an incredibly social value, these data. To your question, Diana, is there too much data? You know, I don't think so. I think the technology sort of comes along for us to manage it. AI is one example that helps to manage sort of the massive amount of data and make sense out of it.
It is really interesting to see, you know, how much there's data overload. A lot of people, I mean, you have so much data that knowing what to look at and what's useful. Where does intuition play a role? Is that factored in anymore? Or what's interesting to me is just looking at the things that make companies successful. And when I wrote about curiosity, I researched what held people back from being curious, because I think curiosity plays such a big role in the success of companies. I mean, they all want to be innovative. They want to be able to create this data and learn these new things. And to me, curiosity is the spark to that. And what I looked at were the things that kept people from being curious, which were fear, assumptions, technology, and environment were the four factors that kept people from being curious.
Yes.
But do you think that companies are encouraging curiosity? And you have favorite examples, I'm sure, of an interactive interaction field companies. Do they encourage curiosity, and where does that play?
See, that's how I see this, is that there is a value. Think of you mentioned your daughter is in a startup in San Francisco and somewhere in the Silicon Valley. I don't know what kind of work she does, but assume that she says, look, farming is very important, healthy food is very important. I want to go into the startup in the agricultural field.
Okay.
If you can do that, and you can sort of go into your whiteboard and do a design thinking routine with a bunch of people and some experts, and then you can create some idea, some app that you could sell to a farmer that improves farming and the productivity of a farm productivity tool, let's say. But think how more powerful that is if you as a startup actually build those ideas on the existing data that are shared by these participants in the what I call the interaction field.
Or is it the open farm source? Farm. Is that what you're saying?
Open source, mm-hmm. Yes, that's what it is. Uh-huh. The key is that it's open source. You know, mm-hmm. When Amazon keeps their data to themselves to sell you more, then it's closed. And I think that the answer, it's actually called the open platform. So it's mm-hmm. an open system. Right. Everybody can join. It's really critical. Mm-hmm. So I encourage a startup, for example, to actually look at what is sort of that, what are the networks available, build your idea on the basis of an existing data set. And to your question on curiosity, the data will not give you the answer for a good business model. What the data enables is something what they call it at MIT, a professor, he calls it the inverted firm. And that means that the data, you can actually, by having this data, sharing this data, you can source curiosity, creativity, and the ideas from a much broader set of people than just your own company. So because we all look at the same data, but we need to still apply the creativity. So the ticket right now to innovation is for companies is really that one. It's not about looking within your own four walls, your R&D department and your consumer insights department. It's not about hiring a consultant who says, I have a better way of thinking about it, or your agency that says, I have some creative people that can help you to think about these things in a new way. It's using the data you have about how a business functions, how the agricultural field or how healthcare functions, and then sharing those data broadly and drive the innovation from the outside. So inverted firm, because it's not inside the firm, it's inverted, it's outside the firm, like open innovation type thing.
Yeah.
I think this is sort of the beauty of the connectivity. It's actually, it puts, to your question, it puts curiosity, creativity in overdrive. It makes it exponentially more valuable rather than thinking that data give you the answers.
Well, you know, I think a lot of companies, you know, they get people, they're thinking in their cubicle or their silo or even just their industry.
Exactly.
I know in my research, in my book on curiosity, I wrote about, you know, a hospital who went to a Formula One race car team to help them with their efficiency. You know, you can go outside.
Yeah.
I think there's going to be a lot of this getting outside your comfort zone. And to me, what curiosity is, it's about getting out of status quo thinking. And I think that's what a lot of companies do. But you know what, when I went beyond curiosity, I started to look into perception. And there's so much of perception in the business world too that causes some issues, and how we look.
Ooh.
We can all look at the same data and come up with new ideas and different ways
Absolutely.
Of looking at it, right? Do you?
I find it so interesting. Yeah, I have this part in my book, a chapter I called, and the example I made is with Lego, which is a client of Vivaldi.
Uh-huh.
And I call it framing. The technical term is called framing,
mm-hmm.
and how you frame your business. So Lego was at one point in time, they said, like, look, we are in a real difficult situation. We sell plastic. We sell plastic blocks. And kids don't want to play that anymore. They like to play video games and stuff like that. And it's become digital. And they actually thought they go out of business. And then they did a study, a consumer insight study, that we drew on in our work. We didn't do the study. They did it in the Lego Foundation. And they mm-hmm. called it the future of play. And then they defined and says, what is really the problem that kids face in growing up and parents face? And they found that the free play, the creative play, the free play and the shared social play with parents is the most important development factor for kids' creativity and schooling and development. It isn't about a confined game like Fortnite where you shoot people down, you know, whatever, something like that, and competition. It's about actually, and they found that parents more and more have less time spending time with their children sitting down. And so based on that, they said, so how can we encourage this? What's our brand about? The brand, we helped them articulate this at some point. The joy of building and the pride of creation are two words that are used in part of their brand position. It's a summary, if you will. We call it an essence of a brand. But then what they did is they had several initiatives. In the book, I described this idea of Lego ideas. You can create anything about Lego ideas. And that's a parent and a son, let's say, or a daughter. Let's say I love the, so one person has, you know, there was this tour by Mick Jagger with this big red tongue, if you remember that. It was the famous tour. I forgot the name.
You're talking about?
Yes, that's right. Uh-huh. There we go. Yeah. I didn't think you would remember.
I'm not old enough to. No, I am old enough.
That's what I thought. So the father, being a rock interested, uh-huh. and rock and roll fan, you know, reproduced this tongue with his son, and mm-hmm. And obviously Lego encourages people to post that on Lego. There's a site on Lego. Lego mm-hmm. Ideas, it's called.
Yeah.
And then if you like that, you need to encourage your friends and family and everyone else to vote in favor of your idea that is tongue from Mick Jagger and build on Lego blocks. And if it gets enough votes, 10,000 votes, Lego decides or not to produce it, and you get 1% of revenues or something. And
that's
this
cool.
has become an enormous success. You know, shared play, you have a creative idea. You don't have to be confined by the Lego set that the Lego produces. You come up with your own idea. You work together with your father or your mother or your uncle, let's say. So there is sort of a shared play. And you can engage and that's a way to source creativity and new ideas from outside the building at Lego in Billund, Denmark. Let's say. So,
well, you know, that's really interesting because I used to train people with Myers-Briggs training in the day when it first, you know, was more popular. We used to give them mm-hmm. Legos. And you put people on teams who were all alike, and you'd give them Legos and you'd ask them to build a house, and then you'd switch it up and you'd put people on teams who were not all alike in their personality type and have them build a house or something. And it was really interesting because the people who were all alike and had the same personality type would build the most boring houses. And then the teams that were all diverse would build like a castle and a moat and all these great things with the Legos, right? And we learned that, you know, the more diverse the team, the more creative the idea, of course, more challenges. That's what I'm thinking of as you said that. But it also brought to mind I Was, the book written by Wozniak. How he talked about his dad bringing home gadgets from work with the electrical wires and different things, and how they sat down together, and it was a form of play, but it was also a form of learning where you would share with why you need this electricity to make this work and why this is required for this to do that. And look what it did for Woz, right? So we need that.
And I see this today with my children here. They connect over video with someone else. They may modify a video. They may sort of produce a video about a particular dance on TikTok. They may share some creations, and then one of them builds or expands on it. So the beautiful thing is in this hyper connected world, you can actually create the diversity that you mentioned in the Myers-Briggs exercise, mm-hmm. and that was. You can actually create that almost like at the global basis, you know, like that people literally work, people you don't know would work on a creation that you have started. At Lego, they have one of these examples called Kronky Wonky. It has no particular name, it's totally made up. Kronky Wonky was this global community that builds whatever you think is a Kronky Wonky. And you know, the Germans were thought a grongy wongy looks like a car. And
that's so funny. My daughter did an exercise like that in grade school. They had her build a gerfel, and I don't even know, yeah. G-I-R-F-L-E or something. They just, you know, made up a word. And all the kids had to come in with what they thought a gerfel looked like. And of course, I got part of that exercise because I helped her build the gerfel. They had to be, I think it was like 6 inches tall, but it had to weigh like a certain amount of weight. But she wanted to sleep with this thing. And so I couldn't put sand in it. So we put marbles in it in case it broke, in case, you know what I mean, to give it some weight. It was really a very creative exercise. And we sewed little overalls on him, and he was a really cute gerfel. But other people came up with things that look like snakes, and you know, the creativity was really a fun thing. So it sounds a little like that, right?
Yeah. And I think, you know, I think that's what the success is of business also, and what I describe in the book of these companies, that it is based on a common sort of a what I call an interaction field, by being through interactions, through connections, being connected, working together, and in order to solve some of the most intractable problems, you know, world hunger, zero CO2 emissions, healthy pets with mass pet food, and on and on and on. There's a health insurance company I discovered in South Africa that actually, if you follow the program of what they sort of prescribe, you add 8 years to your life expectancy. At my age, I tell you, I take those 8 years hands down. So it's impossible, things that we could never have done. But why is it possible? Because we are all connected, and we unleash this creativity in some ways toward a particular solving problems that we couldn't have solved before, you know. So I think that's the world we live in. I think that, so it's a, that's where the ticket to success is of these companies.
It's the cooperation and interaction of all this. And, you know, I think it's a really important book that you wrote, because I think this is a time where we're seeing, I think everybody thought they had a lot of the answers and that everything was going to be a certain way. I think foresight and proactive qualities kind of took a little backseat to what they need to take, because we don't have the control we think we have, right? So I guess, what's the most important thing you think they're going to get from, if they read your book? What are you really trying to send home with your message?
I think that the most important thing is that before companies were able to say, we have the best engineers, we built tractors for 100 years, my name is John Deere, we have the best factories, we have quality initiatives, we have black belts that run our machines most effectively, and therefore you should pay a higher price, because we are German and we sell BMWs, which are the ultimate driving machine.
Right.
There is nothing better, you know, or we are Nike. Nike is better than anybody else, and on and on and on. And we have now found that nobody does it alone. Nobody. If you really want to solve the problems that that consumers face today, let's say, or an entire industry faces, or an entire society faces, climate control, climate, or cancer, or the pandemic issue, the COVID-19 situation, you need to figure out how to leverage this connectivity. This hyper connectivity of everything. You need to begin sharing data. It's not about shareholder value anymore. I run a company that is profitable and everybody is happy and I get rich. It's about shared value, because what happens is, even if you share out value, it the pie of the market grows, so everyone is better off. That is a mindset, Diana.
Right.
A mindset that you have to wrap your arms and your head around it. And it's not that easy, because, you know, like, you like to think that you are very special, and right. And you need to keep everything very much What is special about you?
Well, didn't Thomas Edison have to buy a lot of patents and all to create the light bulb? I mean, there are so many other factors involved in any creation, aren't there? I mean, even in those days. And so I think that it's an interesting cooperative time to look. And I think younger generations are open to that. And I think that we didn't do it that way in the Mad Men days so much.
No.
Times have changed quite a bit. And I'm hoping that a lot of people can learn a lot from your book. As I said, the interaction field, the revolutionary new way to create shared value for businesses, customers, and society. I know they're going to want to read your book and follow you. So I just was hoping
you could
share some. You're welcome. I was hoping you could share like a link or some place to follow you. Is there some social media or something you'd like to share?
Oh, yeah. Obviously, I am on LinkedIn. I usually go with the initial of my first name, so E, and then like Eric, and then my long last name, Joachimsthaler. Nobody will ever figure that out.
You'll have to look at my blog to read that. Yeah.
It took me many years, even in grade school, in elementary school, to get my name right. I was almost getting a psychological disorder on that. Everybody could write the name except Eric.
That's
but
great.
Anyway, so the best way, another way to do it is look at our website, Vivaldi, VivaldiGroup.com, www.VivaldiGroup. There's a way to buy the book or a way to see sort of get a free copy or something like that. I'm also on Twitter to be found. And I have actually my own website. It's called www.ErichJoachimsthaler.com. And again, that's a useless URL. But
I bet you didn't have a problem finding that one either. I bet you.
There we go. Maybe on Google. Maybe on Google has given me a page rank high enough that when you type something close to it, you find me.
Yeah. Okay, Eric, this was so much fun. And I thought you have so much great information, and you have such authorities out there saying great things about your book for good reason. And I was so glad that you were able to join me on the show today. Thank you.
Thank you, Diana. Thank you so much. Most appreciated.
Oh, you're welcome. It's so much fun. And we will be back right after this message. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank Eric for being my guest today. We get so many great guests on the show. Eric is so interesting. I hope you take some time to check out some of his talks he's given. It's really entertaining and educational. Everything he talks about is fascinating because it ties into what companies are trying to do right now, be more innovative and creative and, of course, curious. So it was really wonderful having Eric on the show. But we get so many great guests, and I know it's hard to catch them all. So if you've missed any past episodes, you can go to drdianehamilton.com and find them there, of course, on iTunes and everywhere else podcasts are listed. But if you want to read the show instead of listen to it, you can go to the blog on my site. So once you get there, just pick blog. And they're all transcribed, so it's kind of nice because if you want to check out Eric's or somebody else's books or whatever we've talked about on the show, there's a link to it there, and it'll take you right to the site. So I hope you take some time to check that out. You can also find out more if you want to contact me regarding speaking or writing and all the things that I do. The book, Cracking the Curiosity Code, or the work with Power of Perception, or any of the assessments, the Curiosity Code Index, or the Perception Power Index, everything is on the website. So if you don't find it, can't locate it, you can always contact me through the site, and I'm happy to answer any questions about that. But doing some amazing work with some of the major organizations around the world to ensure that companies are more innovative and creative, and that all starts with the spark of curiosity. And so doing great talks and training with organizations to ensure that they learn about the things that are inhibiting their curiosity. And if you're interested in knowing more about that, you can go to my site or go right to developcuriosity.com and take a quick little course. It's free, and it gives you a whole lot of more insight into the value of curiosity. And we're also recently launched a MOOC around the world, MOOC, which is a massive open online course as part of Future Learn. So if you're interested in taking a course there, that also is free. And you could just go to Future Learn and search for my name or Curiosity, and you should be able to find it easily there. So there's no excuse for not being curious anymore, and there's a lot of ways to find all the information. So hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.